So, namaskar everyone. We are joined here by Dr. Nita Verma, who is the Director General of National Informatics Center, NIC, Government of India. And NIC is the premier IT implementation backbone of the government. And NIC is a pioneer in the implementation of e-health projects across the country. So I will request Dr. Nita Verma to deliver a keynote address, giving her vision about IT in health in India, and also in the perspective of the health stack and NDHM, the National Digital Health Mission, announced by the Government of India. Over to you, Dr. Nita Verma. Thank you.
Thank you, Ravi. Good afternoon, everyone. Digital India program has propelled induction of technology in almost every sector of socio-economic development. In fact, today, digital transformation is an important component of strategy or vision of every entity. Health sector has also leveraged technology in its many facets, right from management of hospitals, to online appointment for citizens in far-flung areas, particularly to big tertiary hospitals, where they had to otherwise go and sit in queues for a long time. Management of national and state level programs for eradication, prevention, or control of various diseases. Medical science, medical electronics, and so on and so forth. All these things, if you have a look at it, have brought a lot of efficiency in the not only the internal functioning of these organizations, hospitals, better monitoring of various programs, better outcomes. It has also given some amount of convenience to citizens also when they interact with these facilities or when they are at the receiving end of benefits under various schemes. All this put together has actually brought a lot of efficiency, but still an affordable access to quality healthcare still is a challenge for many people in India. Ayushman Bharat program launched by Honorable Prime Minister has addressed the challenge of affordability for a large number of people to a great extent, but access to quality healthcare continues to be a challenge. COVID, onset of COVID, while brought a lot of challenges for us, but it also somewhere brought in the forefront the role of technology in delivery of healthcare services. If you see during these COVID times, lot of interventions have been done in terms of a launch of a number of telemedicine platforms. There has been specific interventions on management of inventory and assets in these COVID hospitals, tracking of patients or COVID positive patients and their contacts, so which they normally call contact tracing. Aarogya Setu app was launched to give a data-driven, technology-driven solution to this contact tracing issue. And today, you know, it is one of the largest contact tracing app in whole of a world, with 16.6 crore downloads of this app in few these things like this. And similarly, if you look at all COVID tests as being aggregated at a common portal in ICMR portal, and from there then disseminated to all agencies who are in one way or other involved in the containment of this whole COVID-19 spread. At the same time, but in all those things, technology has really brought, and telemedicine has also brought, because today, see, in our country, we under Digital India program, one thing which we have witnessed in last 5 years is the revolution of this broadband in the country. The affordable access to internet, affordable access to connectivity has become a reality for many people in the far-flung areas of India. Now, for doing telemedicine, connectivity was a prerequisite, this thing. Second thing was the willingness, or I should say the the converse the kind of familiarity with the healthcare professionals with this kind of platform and their belief, and also of the patients. Patients also will prefer to go and meet doctor in person instead of consulting on these things. Telemedicine, COVID brought that kind of an emergency where you just can't go out of your house, and doctors also could not really, I mean, many of the times for the general consultations, even hospitals were also closed in the beginning days. So it became a necessity for the patients and the for doctors to meet on the teleconsultation platforms. The good thing is just it kind of broke that ice, you know, that yes, this is not the way to do it, and has really convinced many people because they had first-hand experience of being consulted by a doctor, and doctors also had an experience of this, talking to patients on these teleconsultation platforms. In some of the places, they have even integrated their hospital management software so that all medical records of doctors, patient is available to the doctor while doctor is trying to give advice to the patient. So what I'm really going to, I am anticipating that and then government also released telemedicine guidelines, the way government released work from home guidelines. So this whole thing put together has brought telemedicine in the forefront. And I hope and wish COVID will go very soon, but I am very sure that this telemedicine or teleconsultation platforms are going to really grow and grow in the times to come. Because that, as I was telling you, the access to quality healthcare, people who are in the remote areas where they can't get this kind of consultation, is a challenge. And this gives them an economic and time-saved manner of connecting and consulting to any doctor in India. And tomorrow it can go in the global sense also that way. So telemedicine is one thing which I am very hopeful, and I would like to see more and more hospitals really adopting these kind of things. In certain time of every doctor could be given. It also brings a lot of convenience. In fact, I have heard a number of personal success stories from the doctors where they really feel empowered, and they also feel that they're able to manage their time well because now they could do their other things as well as consult the patients at the time of convenience of both of them. Going forward now, if we see, supposing now if access is available, what is the other problem which patients face? Problem is, you must have seen in the hospitals, and God forbid if sometimes you have someone in the family who has any critical ailment, people carry this whole set of big bags, you know, with all those x-rays, MRI reports and pathology reports and all those things whenever they are consulting doctor from one place to other place. In this process, sometimes you may misplace your records, sometimes you may in some hospitals you may not get those MRI and x-ray copies at the same time. It's an inconvenience, first of all. If the record gets damaged, you can't be really seen, supposing x-ray gets damaged or things like this. And also, if you do not have access, many a times you have to undergo the same set of tests again, and which also brings a financial burden to many people who are otherwise, you know, you've seen sometimes in critical ailments, people really, you know, lose, I mean, their financial condition goes so bad at times. And then these repetitive tests, and they really put a lot of cost on an individual. So how do you really make an individual access to his or her own health records on a mobile app, this or on any kind of a desktop? For this, in National Digital Health Blueprint and now National Digital Health Mission, which is a body formed to implement that blueprint, this is one of the important agenda. So that every one of the important mission, and as I understand, they have already launched an app to this where a person will be able to access to his or her own health records. And if supposing you have shown at three different places, this app going forward will provision you to see all your health records from those three hospitals or five hospitals at one place, in whichever way you will can personalize them to view by date wise or by hospital wise, whichever way. That's just a simple technology solution. And then you tomorrow, supposing you have shown at one place and you've undergone some investigations and you want to show it to the next facility, you will be able to show. But In all these deliberations, privacy and security has been kept at the core of the design. Therefore, there is a very evolved consent framework mechanism into it. Anybody, if any doctor or any health facility wants to have a look at your records, you as an individual who is the owner of the record has to provide a consent. Only when you provide a consent, they will be able to. Supposing you have gone to Apollo Hospital and you undergone some investigation, then you go to All India Institute of Medical Sciences. So when you go to All India Institute of Medical Sciences, if they want to have access to MRIs or any kind of CT scans have been done in Apollo, then you will give a consent, and basis your consent, they will be able to access those whichever records you would like to show it to them. So privacy is taken care through consent. Security in any case is underlying to all these infrastructures. And the best part is that it is not that, and the beautiful thing in this whole thing is this electronic health record is a federated health record. That means there is no single repository we are making where we are going to keep all these health records. These health records will continue to be in digital systems of respective hospitals, respective clinics. Only on patient's request, by giving a consent, this record will be shown to the individual, will have an access to this thing, and also to the respective doctors where you want to consult going forward. So this federated health record is a very beautiful concept. It saves from government to put a common repository and then get into all kind of complications. There's a lot of cost involved in that process. All that gets saved. So that is one thing which is now started to begin. And I'm sure you will see all these things rolling out in a big way, because more and more hospitals have to onboard. Now, when supposing if I go on 10 places, how will I be identified? So therefore, there is a concept of unique health ID to be given to every person. If you mention that unique health ID, or if your unique health ID gets mapped, that will be the mechanism through which, and therefore nowadays National Digital Health Mission portal is on, where you can go and obtain a unique health ID for yourself, which then can be used for accessing your electronic health records through various channels like web portal or a mobile or any other mechanism as we move forward. So unique health ID is one core concept which is needed to avail all these facilities which will come. Second thing is, now we also have to register all the health facilities. Otherwise, how will you connect and how will you know? And when we are talking of health facilities, we are not talking of not only the big hospitals or the government hospitals or the PHC in the villages. We are showing even neighborhood clinics in our private, where one doctor, two doctors kind of establishments. Even all of them will register to this health facility registry. Everybody will have a unique health facility registry number, and through which this connection of UHID of the patient and health facility register number, you will be able to connect these things. There is also a concept prescribed of a registry, national level registry of the doctors and the nurses to begin with. And those are also getting formed with the help of respective medical associations and all, which is called, which they are, I think, naming as DigiDoctor, through which all the doctors who are registered medical, who are practicing in India, all their registry will be available, which could also, that once you have one-person clinic, two-person clinic, you can also check the antecedents, and you also know which doctor had treated you, and so on and so forth. So this is an underlying mechanism. You need to have health facility registry, you need to have doctors and nurses registry, you need to have a unique health ID. Once you have these systems in place, over that, then you will have this federated electronic health record, and then My Health app, where you will be able to access, and later all these insurance schemes and all that ecosystem. So one, what is that is needed? People who are in the health digital health solutions and all, what you need to do is, whatever health systems you have, you IT systems you have, you need to connect them to these systems. Like, I'll give you an example. We have e-hospital system, which is an end-to-end hospital management system, which is working in around 400 hospitals, very big ones like AIIMS and NIMHANS, and also in PHCs at some places. It's a cloud-based solution. So this e-hospital system is already operational. we have made a provision in this thing that if someone will passes a UHID to this number in the standard which is prescribed, which is very much aligned to the international standards, the record, the electronic health record of that person will be able to kind of send on to this. Similarly, wherever we will now, we are installing, we will comply to that health facility registration. So this is just an example. So same kind of a thing with your applications you could do. And for that also, one first thing which has been done, I think for the first time in any of the initiative of government, has brought a concept of this sandbox. So in this sandbox is a place where all the APIs through which you can connect to UHID system, you can connect to health facility registry, you can connect to DigiDoctor, and many other things, they are already available. You need to register, and using that API, you can develop or modify your, adapt your system to this. You can test it there, and then there's a process through which you can get the approval that this is a national health digital health mission compliant application. So that way, your existing applications, if will comply, that will give you much more benefits, because maybe there are some government programs where you will be required. So early you do, the better it is. Second thing, message to all the startups and all who are working in this health sector, if they would like to also develop new kind of mobile app, simple thing, even showing a health record to an individual, considering the demography and the diversity of individual, the public, the citizens we have in this country, you can have 10 different variants that how will you present this electronic. There's a scope of lot of innovation to be done there itself. So those kind of apps could also be designed around this, and then you can consult with National Digital Health Mission and get them kind of approved and all. So this program is not only coming up something which is cutting across government at central state level, as well as various other hospitals run by public sector units in their campus, as well as private sector hospitals, as well as hospitals run under by various charities and trusts, is going to bring the entire health system into one framework, and will definitely make life much more simpler and easier for the citizens, much more convenient. And we all look forward to this. Is also establishing a lot of new kind of things, a new kind of directions for participation of startups, participation of industry in aligned to a common mission of providing, again I said, affordable and accessible quality healthcare to each and every Indian in the country. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Linda ji. Bas ek one question which we got in the Q&A, people have been asking that a lot of new technologies are emerging. There is a emergence of artificial intelligence and machine learning and several other new things are emerging. So how do you look at incorporating these new tech innovations inside the emerging health IT?
Thank you.
Health,
I think it's an excellent question. Artificial intelligence and machine learning will have a lot of potential in healthcare. In fact, we have already seen a lot of innovation happening around. I've seen a lot of startups have come up with systems where, you know, we're looking at the angiography of eye picture. They can find out the person has a diabetic retinopathy, which is a disease which can lead to irreversible blindness. Or a lot of people have come up with looking at X-ray pictures through which you can diagnose whether the person has a COVID or has a pneumonia, and so on and so forth. So this image recognition and basis that, how can an engine help? As I said, quality healthcare is an issue. Supposing it's a doctor in the primary health center, and if you could put these kind of algorithms, I had also seen some startup has done a very beautiful work where looking at the ECG, they can tell what is the criticality of the patient to be taken to the hospital. So primary health care person is normally a generalist. So he may not have been up to date into all these complexity of disease which is happening around us. So these kind of engines, AI ML engines, if they could be plugged to these systems, they can help assist these doctors, in kind of coming up with the diagnosis and making person reach to the next level of hospital and thus save his life and save him all this trauma of getting. So early diagnosis we have seen in whether it is carcinoma, cancer, or it is diabetes, or it is even cardiac diseases. If diagnosis happens earlier, in fact, in some places they have even given in minutes. If it gets earlier, the probability of person's life of being saved becomes much, much higher, many fold higher. So I think these kind of algorithms can really assist doctors on the ground, guide them, assist them with the latest in the field, and say that this is what is kind of needed. So that kind of intervention I see very widespread. In fact, in NIC also we've done two things. We had experimented with COVID also by seeing the chest x-ray. You can kind of do system can tell that this person is likely to have COVID. Now what we have done, we have come with a project called Collab DD, teleradiology, in which what will happen, and we are integrating in our e-hospital system as well as CDEX e-Sushrut system, wherein what will happen that in the PHC, supposing X-ray machine will be there, if the X-ray has been taken, that but there is no one to read that X-ray, you need radiologists to read those X-ray. Those X-ray could be transmitted using the same software along with, because when you see an X-ray, you also want to know what is the general condition of the patient at the same time. So all these things in this will be referred to the experts in the district level hospitals or even at the higher level hospitals. And then they can diagnose that this is the kind of line of treatment this person should be given. So these kind of tools we are kind of integrating into our existing solutions. Similarly, telemedicine and so on and so forth. If they integrate into these systems, they will help or empower our field level doctors to give quicker diagnosis and help people on the ground to reach to the. As I've been always saying, I mean, this can help us giving better quality of care to the people while they continue to be in their villages, any part of the country.
Sure. So with this I think we have got a excellent overview of the IT and health ecosystem as being envisaged by MIT and NIC, and a lot of excellent points have emerged from the speech of Dr. Nita Verma regarding IT and health. And I thank her for joining us in spite of her very, very hectic schedule. Thank you so much, Anita ji, for joining us. We are grateful to you. And we will end this session here, and we will start with our next session very soon. Thank you so much. Thank you. Namaskar.